This finally gets us into the third step, retrieval. From encoding to storage to retrieval. And retrieval is really the technical name when you say remembering. You know, in everyday language, when you say I remember this or remember that, you're specifically referring to the more generic technical term, retrieval. Retrieval is the process by which previous experiences are brought back in their working memory. And you remember that arrow that ran from long-term memory back to short-term memory, because anytime you remember something, you're always bringing it back into short-term memory. Right? Based upon the information processing model, memories get stored as a long-term memory. They're there. You're not consciously aware of them. And then one by one, you can pull them out and then use them in short-term memory. And then if you move on to another memory or a current event that you're paying attention to, that memory will simply decay over the course of 30 seconds and it'll be gone. Its original copy will remain in long-term memory. It's just that the copy of it that you used that was residing in short-term memory simply degrades and disappears. And this, you know, you can get back to that metaphorical connection to the computer systems. You know, if you're storing a Microsoft Word document on your laptop because you're writing a final paper, you can shut your laptop off completely, come back a week later, turn it back on, and get an exact copy of that paper again. And that's kind of the retrieval process. Of course, the one distinction here where you have to make a difference between a human brain and a computer system is you obviously don't shut off. And when you are not using a memory, that memory itself may actually decay somewhat on its own. And as we'll actually see in this retrieval section, by retrieving a memory and using it, you may actually modify the memory a little bit and then place a modified version of the memory back into long-term memory so that the original event, which may be stored, and let's pretend it's stored perfectly accurately in the beginning, which is really more a hypothetical than anything, but we have an original memory stored perfectly. We retrieve it. We use it in short-term memory. And based upon the current events at that time, we slightly modify the memory and we put it back in and restore it and do this over and over and over again. The memory that's stored in long-term memory may actually become corrupted. And then you'll wind up thinking something that actually never had happened. But we'll get to that as we go along, but it's retrieval is a very important process because it's not just about getting information back. There's a lot of other things that go on in the system. Now, there's two basic forms of retrieval, recall and recognition. And recall and recognition are not separate forms of retrieval. They are two ends of a continuum. And it's very important for you to remember that, because retrieving anything is just like any of the associative work that we've been doing. You associate two cues together. If you present one, you kind of retrieve a connection to the other one. And that's what's actually happening in this case. But the terms recall and recognition tend to be somewhat related to human beings specifically, because they oftentimes involve language behavior in this case. And let's take a look at recognition first, because this one's a little bit easier to work with. Recognition, thankfully, has been named well, because the term recognition is used in the same way that you can use it in everyday language. That is, if I say I recognize my home, that's because I have been there before, I have seen it, and now I'm currently looking at it. So I have a memory of what my home looks like. I'm looking at the home now, and I'm matching up the memory to the current event that I'm experiencing, and I'm saying they're the same thing. That's recognition. And recognition operates when you do things like multiple choice exams. When you have a multiple choice exam, as you do in this course, you might have five answers. You have a question with five possible answers. Those five answers essentially are like a police lineup. Which one of these answers is guilty? Right? You want to distinguish the one guilty answer, the one you want to pick out, from the other four that are actually incorrect. And that is the same way in which recognition operates. You are maximally stimulating the subject with retrieval cues. You're not telling the person what is the right thing, but you can give as many cues as you want that constantly dance around the right answer. But you can't give the right answer itself. That's what recognition is. Recall, on the other hand, is actually where you try to minimize the number of cues that are related to the correct answer. So you're trying to be as vague as possible. And in scenarios like this, it would be more closely related to something like an essay exam. So for example, if we weren't going to have a multiple choice exam, but instead we were going to do an essay exam, I could give you an extremely difficult essay exam. And the essay exam would be for you to fill up a blue book with your answer with this one essay question. Tell me everything you learned since the last exam. That would be your essay question. Tell me everything you learned since the last exam. Now, that question is not telling you what chapters we covered. It's not telling you the names or dates of any of the people or any of the events that occurred. It's not giving you any organization of the material inside the chapters. It's giving you as little information as possible that serves as an example of recall as a form of retrieval because it is optimally vague. Now, retrieval itself can be seen in a number of different ways, and all of them overlap with everything you've seen in the learning chapter. In fact, in this particular case, I'm not repeating the same slide that you saw earlier in the learning chapter and the memory chapter with the list of the basic factors for all things that affect learning and memory, which overlap completely. Retrieval is affected by all of those same variables. And so you could talk about the aspects of psychophysics and the gestalt for the context, your attention and so forth, all the aspects of generalization, symbolic meaning, they all affect retrieval. So you're still operating by the same underlying principles of any aspect of psychology that involves associating cues together or any of the basic principles that underlie the basic operation of your nervous system. So there's one basic rule, one very simple basic rule in this case, and that is this. The more similar a retrieval cue is to the previous experience, the greater the likelihood the memory will be retrieved. And so, and in fact, that should make somewhat sense because if you're experiencing as much of the cues in the environment around a particular event, that is very much like the process of recognition, right? You are actually delivering as many cues as possible to try to bring back a memory as opposed to anything else. And so it's a very simple, straightforward rule, but you see it play out in a lot of different ways. Like for example, if, for example, you moved around a lot when you were young, but you still sort of remembered some of the old houses you lived in. If you had a sibling and you went back to one of those old houses, stood in front of it and maybe even got to go inside and began to talk to your sibling about life experiences that occurred, you know, what was Christmas morning like, or what was a time when, you know, you fell down the steps, or any other kind of significant event that might have occurred. All of those cues, being actually in the environment itself, being with somebody who may have actually been there, maximize the chances for retrieval under those circumstances. But if under the same hypothetical scenario that you lived in a different home in a different state when you were 3 years old, and you brought me to your home and start to talk about these things, it is very unlikely that I would serve as any sort of retrieval cue because I was not there. I'd never been to that house. I wasn't with you when you were three. I am completely disconnected from any of those events, and therefore my presence and anything I say would very unlikely help you remember any aspect of anything that had happened to you at that earlier time. Now, some examples of retrieval that occur are things like state-dependent memory, congruent moods, and failure to encode, which is actually another process. State-dependent memory and congruent moods effect are actually very similar to each other because they are, again, working from the same process where more similar retrieval cues will make it more likely you remember things, which is again connected to the whole process of recognition. In state-dependent memory, what's called state-dependent memory, is simply a scenario in which if something is learned in one environment and then you are in a separate, very different environment, you're simply less likely to retrieve that information. And that should follow the basic underlying principle of the stimulating the environment and the associations that that environment holds. One of the places where state-dependent memory actually is applied is understanding alcoholic blackouts or other types of drug-induced blackouts. When a person is very, very drunk, they are probably still forming memories, but the memories that they form during that time are associated with the presence of alcohol. And so the following morning or the following day when they have sobered up and they cannot remember the previous night, that's when they're experiencing a blackout. Okay, the following day, they can't remember what they did the night before. Now, given everything I've already told you here, that the more similar retrieval cue is to the previous experience, the more likely to remember it. And of course, that's the same thing as recognition. How do you suppose a person who has had an alcoholic blackout could remember what had happened? So let's say they went to a party, they lost their car keys, they were really, really drunk, and they woke up on the street, right? They slept on the sidewalk, being as drunk as they were. The following day, when they wake up and they're sober, they can't remember where their keys are. What would you do? Well, even though this may be impractical and maybe not healthy for a person that drinks this much, the way to get them to remember where the car keys were is to start drinking again. Because as they drink again, the alcohol will serve as a cue to recall or retrieve the memories that the individual had from the previous evening when they were drunk. And then they will increase the chance that they will remember where they had lost their keys. The congruent moods effect is really the same story here, except you're working with a person's mood, the state of their mood, and the kinds of memories that are actually formed during that time. So if happy or sad events occur to you during the course of your life, you form memories of those events when you're happy or when you're sad. Later on, years later, when you're happy or sad, you simply have a tendency to remember all the happy times of your life or all the sad times of your life. And so this becomes a problem in scenarios, for example, with clinicians that do marital therapy. With a couple that doesn't get along, they, because they're not happy, they tend to remember only the unfortunate or sad or anger-inducing aspects of the relationship because they're not happy with that person. And as a result, when they start therapy, they have a tendency to blame each other for the problems and to only remember the bad things about their life together. One of the very simple ways to kind of get around this problem, you know, and simple theoretically, I say, not in a practical sense, is to get that couple to do something enjoyable together. And if they work, if they go do something enjoyable together, like a picnic or a movie or whatever it is that works for them, you know, and it'd be specific to that couple, simply get them in a good mood. They will be more likely to remember good things about the other person. And that is a very basic way to kind of start therapy. Because if you have two people that are just blaming each other for all their problems, therapy's not going to go anywhere. You simply have to change their mood as a way to kind of activate a little bit more communication or forgiveness or other aspects in the therapy that very likely are going to happen. Congruent mood effect also explains why a night's sleep makes you feel better, which oftentimes, you know, when somebody is angry and somebody, we give them advice and tell them to sleep on it and they'll probably feel better tomorrow. That literally does work, and it works in part because your mood will change as you sleep. And why would your mood change when you sleep? Well, simply because you relax your body, right? You go to sleep, you become unconscious, your entire body relaxes, and then you wake up in the morning with in a relaxed physical state. Now, of course, it is possible to wake up somewhat angry in the morning, but you won't be as angry as you were when you went to bed. And so by going to sleep, you physically change your state, your physical state of degree of relaxation, and that will wind up changing your mood. Of course, if going to sleep changes your mood because you relax your body, another way to do that also is to meditate. And meditating is, of course, an increasingly popular topic that comes up today. And it does have a lot of benefits. And meditating when you're angry to calm yourself down certainly operates this way. And the congruent moods effect doesn't explain the entire process, but it is a significant aspect to understand how your mood can change if you sat down and properly meditated, which very likely is going to relax your body. Now, I mentioned state-dependent memory and the congruent moods effect were very, very similar to each other. One that it operates from a separate standpoint is the issue of failure to encode. Failure to encode simply is a scenario in which you do not encode a memory, and as a result, you simply don't have a memory to retrieve. And you can see that is a completely separate issue from state-dependent memory or congruent moods effect because both of those aspects involve formed memories and your ability to retrieve them. In failure to encode, you never form a memory. Therefore, when you attempt to retrieve it because you don't realize you don't have it, there's nothing there for you to retrieve. One of the best examples of this are come from looking at currency. Here on the bottom of the bottom of the slide, you see an American penny. Now, an American penny is the only currency that is copper colored. And if you ever see a copper colored coin in American currency, you know it's a penny. You don't have to look at it any further. You don't have to know that it says, "In God we trust." You don't have to know what president's on it. You don't have to know what's on the back or in the front. You don't have to know which direction Abraham Lincoln is facing, where the date is on there, if the word liberty is on there or not. And as a result, people only look at the color. So when you ask people in general, can they reproduce from memory an image of a penny, or even give them a lineup of a bunch of examples of artistic renderings of pennies, one of which is correct and many others which are not? People are very poor at getting that kind of information. It's the same thing with paper currency as well. If you're holding bills in your hand, the only thing about that bill that's relevant to you is the number in the corner. It's a 1, it's a 5, it's a 10, it's a 20, it's a 50, or 100. That's it. That's the only thing that matters. Who the president is, whether they change the president, if they change where the serial numbers are, if they change some of the colors or the diagrams on the front and the back, it just simply doesn't matter. The only thing that really matters in a practical sense is the number in the corner of the bill. The rest of it simply is not looked at carefully enough to form a long-term memory. And now, if you wanted to do such a thing, you would have to engage your rehearsal system, look at a bill very carefully, remind yourself of what is there, connect it to other aspects, connect it to how other bills are made. It's a lot of work. In fact, probably the only people that would do such a thing are people from the Secret Service that work in counterfeiting, maybe the engraver or the artist that form currency, or other people that kind of work at the Treasury office. They would be the only individuals that actually would have some significant reason to spend a fair amount of time actually looking at the great deal of detail on currency. The rest of us, we just need to know the number in the corner, and that's it. So let's take a look at a question that's related to failure to encode. If failure to encode explains why most people cannot draw a penny from memory, can failure to encode explain why some people do not recall social events that others find completely obvious? And the answer there is yes. Of course they do. And in fact, this gets back to a perceptual issue. Every person in a group that's talking together all have separate life histories, and as a result they all may have slightly different perceptual experiences of the meeting of these individuals that have come together and they're all talking to each other. And some of those individuals may be very focused on fine details of somebody else's behavior, whereas other members of the group will be completely ignoring it because they're not even aware that it occurs at all. And after the meeting, some people will be very focused on how somebody was rude or somebody was nice, and other people will have completely missed the point, not noticed at all, because from their perceptual standpoint, these events actually never occurred because they didn't notice them, because those are not things from their life history that they would wind up focusing on. So the failure to encode process, it does apply in a variety of different ways, certainly in very practical ways regarding things like currency, details of events, of social experiences, as well as other kinds of details for technical manuals and so forth, where people might miss details that are relevant for them. Now, this gets us to the false memory syndrome issue, which is a primary concern for the field of memory. False memory syndrome really started to become highlighted sometime around the 1980s, the 1980s was during a time where there was a lot of false memory claims. There was a lot of really poor work done by a number of clinicians who were using hypnosis to hypnotize their patients and try to revert them back to an earlier point in their life where they would relive a memory. And a lot of these ideas, the ideas that you can hypnotize a person, bring them back to an earlier point in their life, have them relive a memory, and possibly bring back some repressed memory, are all concepts from Freudian psychoanalysis. And again, we haven't talked about Freud yet much this semester, except to constantly refer to him as a fellow who had a lot of bad ideas. And in fact, the work of Freud is of no relevance today in scientific psychology. However, there are a number of clinicians that still do practice from a Freudian standpoint. And why that is the case is an entirely separate issue. just accept the fact that they are out there and they are, you know, they are doing therapy legally, even though it may not have a lot of scientific value to it. But during the 1980s, a lot of these false memory syndrome claims started to come out where adults in therapy who go through this process of hypnosis begin to have false memories implanted into their head by the therapist. And this is not a process that occurs through the volition of the therapist himself. The therapist actually doesn't realize that they're doing it. And we're much more aware of the issue now, but in the 1980s, it was less well recognized, where scenarios would occur that a person would have an emotional problem. They would go to therapy. They would unfortunately pick this therapist that was working from a Freudian psychoanalytic standpoint who would hypnotize them, try to revert them back to an earlier point in their life, and keep asking them questions about whether or not they were abused as a child or sexually abused or neglected, and kind of keep focusing on those aspects of their life because the therapist thought the symptoms they displayed as an adult seemed to indicate that they might have been sexually abused as a child. Now, all of these assumptions come from a Freudian psychoanalytic standpoint, and they are not really very valid approaches to work with therapy. So they focus on it, and they keep asking the person on the therapy whether or not they were abused. Because they keep saying no, and the therapist asks them again, they say no, and the therapist asks them again, they say no, and this happens over and over and over again. Eventually, the patient will wind up saying yes. And then the therapist will start giving much more attention to that individual in therapeutic sessions. And it will start to drive a process while the patient is actually in therapy and not fully conscious of what's happening, that they will start forming memories of experiences where they were actually sexually abused as a child. And as this takes place over the course of months and possibly a year, they eventually form a full-on false memory of having been abused. And once that occurs, as you might imagine, the therapist then encourages them to go to the police. And oftentimes the person who is actually implicated is the individual's father. And so there's a rash. In fact, you can look these cases up online very easily through Google of fathers being arrested because their adult daughter was convinced she was sexually abused as a child. But as time goes by, you eventually find out that the therapist implanted the memory in her head, and then she came to believe it fully, enough so that she went to the went to the police to have her father arrested. And in many cases, these individuals actually went to court, were tried, and amazingly, found guilty. Found guilty on the single eyewitness testimony event of the individual with the false memory. And that is a really horrific story to tell. And it was told repeatedly back in the 80s into the 90s before the American Psychological Association started to step up and began investigating these claims specifically. And it started working with the defense attorneys to find out what had actually happened to get these individuals out of prison from the events that had occurred. Now, false memories will play themselves out in the way that I described, but you can take a 2x2 table very similar to the way we did with the sensation and perception chapter with psychophysics and talk about how whether or not an event happened and whether or not an event was retrieved. So in terms of sensation of perception, we talked about the process of whether or not a stimulus was present or absent. In this case, we talk about the event. Did the event really happen or did it not happen? Okay. And then in sensation and perception, we talked about whether or not the person detected the cue or did not detect the cue. In this particular case, in terms of memory construction, we talk about whether or not an individual retrieved the memory or did not retrieve the memory. Of course, if an event actually happened and the person retrieved it, that is a perfectly accurate memory. Well, at least as accurate as it might be. If an event never happened and the person claims that it never happened, that would be an accurate response. If an event actually did happen, but the person does not remember it, right? They cannot retrieve it. It's possible that the memory has been forgotten, or separately, it's possible that there is not retrieval for the memory, but the memory actually does exist. And that's a very important thing. You have to distinguish between a memory that is forgotten, in which case we're going to say physically in your brain has been wiped out. It was a memory you formed that the cells have now been used for other memories, and it simply doesn't exist any longer. It's also possible that, like me, as your instructor, trying to help you remember things that happened to you when you were 3 years old simply serve as a poor retrieval cue. And as a result, the memory may literally still be in your brain, but you're not under the proper environmental conditions to retrieve it. And so the event actually did happen, but the individual is not retrieving it. Can you distinguish between a forgotten memory and a retrieved memory? Only if the memory actually becomes retrieved. At the time during which the person simply says, I can't remember anything, there is no current way to accurately identify the difference between a forgotten and fully lost memory versus an event where the memory actually exists, but the person is unable to retrieve it. And then finally, in the last box, if an event never happened, but the individual retrieves it, that is where your false memory occurs. And those memories can occur through sloppy clinical work, like we're talking about, but they can also occur through natural processes where you're not even aware of it, where an event occurs, you form a memory, and then maybe the people that you talk to about that memory remember the event differently. So if you and your friends all go skiing and you remember the events of the skiing trip differently than your friends and they talk about it differently, you may start to come to believe what they tell you and actually start to experience perceptually that those same things happen to you simply because three other people, your friends, all are talking about an event that they swear happened. They're all convinced that it happened. They all talk about it. They say that you were there. They can't believe how you don't remember it. And then you start thinking that you do remember it. That's actually a false memory occurring through a natural process in which nobody's actually doing sloppy clinical work, but you're simply being in a scenario like I mentioned earlier in this video. You form the memory. You retrieve the memory, you modify it slightly in short-term memory, and then you restore it in a modified form. Then you pull the modified memory out, you reuse it again in short-term memory, and then you store it back in a further modified form. And again, and again, and again, and again. Children are very susceptible to this sort of thing. Children that are not very aware of their own behavior, their own thoughts, like a four-year-old, six-year-old, they could be made to believe things very easily by just telling them that it happened and then repeating the story to them over and over again. They'll actually just come to believe it. And that's a very important thing with something we're going to be talking about later on, which is eyewitness testimony. And in fact, you may have actually heard about how the police now have to use special interviewing techniques with children. And the reason why children have to be interviewed in very particular, careful ways is because In the past, when people are not aware of the false memory process, police officers who may be convinced of a domestic abuse issue may ask a child things like, "When did your dad hit your mom?" And they'll ask questions that actually tell what the answer is. And children, being very easily manipulated, will just go along with this big scary adult says when they come into the house. And as a result, the father, who may be innocent of a domestic violence crime, will wind up getting arrested because the child implicates the father in the crime, and that leads to a lot of sort of problems. So the same sort of thing happens as well in terms of other aspects of interviews for car accidents, asking individuals not in open-ended questions, but in very specific questions. When you say, "When did the red car ram into the blue car?" When you ask a question that way, you're actually telling the respondent what had happened, and you're already starting to modify their memory at that event. It is best, if you're trying to understand what had happened, ask open-ended questions. So you simply say to the person, "Tell me what you saw," and you don't say anything else. "Tell me what you saw, tell me what you heard." Just stick with the facts and tell me what it was that you experienced. And that would be the best way to actually investigate scenarios under circumstances like this. You have to be very, very careful not to feed answers to the subject because you think something had actually happened. That's definitely a process which would lead to a disruption later on in court. If you find out that a child, for example, was not interviewed properly, or individuals in other types of scenarios were not interviewed properly by the police or by lawyers, that process itself could undermine the defense or the argument from your side of the case about whether or not you are dealing with accurate information. And finally, repressed memories. Now, repressed memories is a topic we've talked about already in a variety of different places throughout the semester. Remember, the whole idea with repressed memories was a emotionally significant event occurred that was so horrific that you repressed it, covered it up some way so that you were not able to bring it back and become aware of it. And that is a process that you still hear people talk about today because there are things that look like repressed memories that are actually very, very much not repressed memories. The idea of the repressed memory, again, comes from Sigmund Freud. It comes in a much more complicated story where you're exposed to an emotionally traumatic event, and that emotionally traumatic event becomes covered up by separate processes called defense mechanisms, that the memory always exists in your brain, but it is blocked by this thing called a defense mechanism. And in Freud's model, his therapy would work to remove the defense mechanism to release the repressed memory, which would act as a cure for the person's mental illness. And there is no good evidence that this is actually a process that works. And in fact, it's oftentimes based on the role of hypnosis, which we've seen back in the States of Consciousness chapter, does not serve well to bring back memories. It does not serve well to activate or bring people back to an earlier part in their life so that they can relive an earlier time period to re-experience the event that occurred. The thing that looks like repressed memories today, where people become confused thinking that they had a repressed memory because the concept of a repressed memory floats about in society as though it's a real thing, even though I'm telling you as a psychologist there's no good evidence for it. The thing that looks like a repressed memory is this. Somebody asks you a question about something, And your first answer is, I don't know. I can't remember. And then later on, you do remember and you think, oh my God, that was a repressed memory. And all that's happening, as we see here, if we hop back a couple of slides, is a scenario in which an event that may have actually happened simply is not being remembered correctly. You may have forgotten it, or you may have a retrieval problem. Now, we know for certain in this case, it was not fully forgotten and lost because eventually you do retrieve it. In this scenario like this, if an event that you're exposed to actually happens and then you cannot remember it, it is simply a retrieval problem. And you know it was a retrieval problem because later on you were able to retrieve it under different environmental conditions with better cues to retrieve that memory. The idea of the repressed memory is that you have this traumatic event that occurs that's highly emotional, but that you cannot remember it, and then you're able to uncover it. Anytime people can't remember things and then later on do, they refer to it as a repressed memory, and that process itself doesn't even fit the original parameters of the way Freud thought of a repressed memory, because repressed memories were always, always, always traumatic events, highly emotional, that were covered up by a separate process called a defense mechanism. So if somebody asks you, a simple question like, do you remember if our teacher said there's class next week? And you're like, no, I don't remember. And an hour later, you say, oh, you know what? That's right. He did say there's no class next week. That doesn't fit the standard for a repressed memory. And you shouldn't really refer to it as a repressed memory. In fact, you shouldn't refer to any memory that you are having difficulty recalling and then later do recall as a repressed memory, because there simply is very little evidence for this type of work, this type of effect. And so it's something that you should just kind of put out of your mind. It's an old idea. There's no support for it, and you should just drop it.